For thousands of years, the merchants, voyagers, and caravans traveling on the Silk Road used Iran or ancient Persia as a transit hub. The country played a significant role in transporting commodities from west to east and vice versa. Ancient Persia, with its numerous bazaars and caravanserais, was one of the main trade stations along the ancient Silk Road, due to its geopolitical position. In recent times, this huge capacity, nonetheless, became stagnant due to war, political conflicts and sanctions, and consequently lack of infrastructure. However, the current international conditions have presented Iran with a terrific opportunity to play a significant role in the broader implementation of the international north-south transport corridor and the Road and Belt Project, and hence transform into a regional trade hub by developing its transit infrastructure. Given the lower costs and shorter time of trade by using its transit corridors, Iran can become the main trade link between Asia and Europe once again, and in the process effectively neutralize the US attempts to isolate the Islamic Republic from the global economy. In fact, Iran's transit potential is proving so attractive that it is among the driving forces behind recent regional diplomacy. Experts believe that economic interdependencies provided by such regional cooperation can establish a measure of rationality and efficiency and perhaps create incentives for peace between long-time adversaries in West Asia. To take a closer look at these potential developments, stay with us on this edition of Iran Today. A few months ago, a pair of trucks from the northernmost United Arab Emirates Princeton of Ras Al Khaimah made their way south to the port at Sharjah. The drivers eased them onto a specialized roll-on roll-off ferry that crossed the Persian Gulf to the Iranian port of Bandar Abbas, where they disembarked at the Shahid Bahonar terminal and made a beeline for Iran's fine multi-lane highways. They headed northwest across Iran to the mountainous frontier with Turkey. Then, upon crossing the Bazargan border, the drivers headed southwest to the Turkish Mediterranean seaport of Mersin. Thus, a new trade route was established, one that regional actors are jumping on and could build the kind of trade ties that encourage peaceful relations in West Asia.
Nowadays, the West Asia region and especially Iran's geography is approximately located at the crossing of north-south and east-west junctions of the world and is considered as the connecting point of the three continents of Asia, Africa and Europe. This very attribute has given Iran's geography a unique political characteristic as well as the identity, capacity and the opportunity of geo-economic character. So if this is used properly, it can bring Iran great economic security and political outcomes.
International experts indicate that the Iran route makes a lot of sense. In all, the trip from the UAE to the Mediterranean takes a mere 6 days, according to the World Road Transport Organization, IRU. That's a fraction of the 21 days or so it would take to get a shipment from the Persian Gulf to the Red Sea through the bottleneck at the Suez Canal and into the Mediterranean Sea.
In terms of infrastructure, we have a high capacity and high quality infrastructure. I mean, Iran's transit network connecting surrounding geography and civilizations to other parts of the world. I believe that our transit routes are of high quality and volume. For instance, wherever there is a shortage of railways, there are definitely high capacity roads. Or wherever there is a need for waterways entrance, definitely we have high capacity ports, be it either the northern shores of Caspian Sea or in the southern shores of the Persian Gulf and the Sea of Oman.
Lawyers who specialize in international sanctions and trade law have commented that at the moment, the biggest historical abnormality is the absence of Iran from the global trading system. The development of this transit corridor makes a lot of sense historically and geographically, in that Iran would play this significant role.
You know that right now we have 12,000 kilometers of railway in the country and 6,000 kilometers of road networks. Of course, this is a huge network. 50-60% of our roads and the majority of our railways have transit capabilities. But to reach the 300 million ton target in the future, in effect, we need to develop our transport networks. I believe we need to act more rapidly in that direction in terms of infrastructure and equipment development.
Since the Iran trade route was opened, roughly 1,000 trucks have made the trip between Turkey and the UAE, mostly carrying goods from west to east, according to numbers provided by the local Turkish officials and media outlets. The products, which are worth millions of dollars in total, include consumer durables, foodstuff, cosmetics, machinery, spare parts, and personal belongings moving back and forth. Apparently, the trips are facilitated by a single set of $30 transit documents issued by the International Road Transport Organization, which are valid in dozens of Eurasian nations.
The current changing international environment has impacted the major international transit corridors or China's Belt and Road Project, either in energy or cargo fields, in a way that they have to depend on this critical strategic region. With the start of the Ukraine war and the challenges in South Caucasus from 2020 onwards, Iran's position has become very important due to the strategic security that its geography offers.
Based on the studies we've done, the crossing of any kind of transit commodity through roads creates about $150 of revenue for us, directly and indirectly, meaning that it creates some revenues for the public sector and some for the private sector. It has benefits for the people of the regions that the transit commodity passes through. But in my opinion, aside from the mentioned value, the overall benefits of tying up business and economy to the geography of Iran in the mold of transit is priceless. And however much the interdependencies of regional and international merchants with Iran increases, we can expect our revenues and benefits help us reach our development targets.
Based on media reports, Pakistan is also taking advantage of a newly launched Iranian route to Turkey, which cuts travel times for goods between South Asia and Europe from upwards of 40 days by sea down to as little as a week. Additionally, Central Asian nations, worried about bottlenecks at Caspian Sea ports that have caused weeks of delays, as well as a war raging in Ukraine that has impeded Eurasian traffic, are looking to Iran to get goods back and forth.
The Azerbaijan issue is a different story. As you know, Azerbaijan has a strategic alliance with Turkey. In this alliance, they have attempted to impact the North-South corridor on the western part of our country. We've been witnessing a certain game that they're playing in terms of military and security issues, for instance, utilizing their leverage towards Armenia. Turkey is working a lot on these issues. On one hand, they come to negotiate, and on the other hand, they utilize the Azerbaijan card. They're doing all they can to impact the Astara to Bandar Abbas corridor and prevent it from full implementation. Well, we have other options, such as the routes that go through Armenia to the Caspian Sea. I believe Azerbaijan will eventually make peace with this issue. But for now, they're mostly functioning as a tool for Turkey. Or we can go beyond that and mention the fact that they allowed Israeli bases into their soil, trying to scare investors from investing in Iran. But the Islamic Republic can naturally do its own countermeasures in order to protect its national interests.
Commercially, the use of Iran as a land route makes complete sense. A global container shortage has upped the cost of sea freight, and the threat of piracy or terrorism at sea has jacked up insurance rates. A land option roughly coinciding with the ancient Silk Road connecting Asia to Europe reduces transit times, lowers insurance and refrigeration costs, eases other transport bottlenecks, and could alleviate supply chain shortages, benefiting businesses and consumers worldwide.
We have an extensive cooperation with Azerbaijan Republic. We share east, west, and also the north-south transit corridors, meaning that the western route of the north-south through Caspian Sea is shared with Azerbaijan. Also, the connection of Nakhchivan and mainland Azerbaijan is through the Iranian territory. So, we have common benefits in the mentioned corridors. But we also have competition in certain aspects, especially in the route that crosses the Caspian Sea. I don't call it anything but competition. We are competing on alternative routes.
Other land options are less feasible. Currently, Iraq bars transit transportation within its borders, and huge areas of Syria remain unstable and in a state of armed conflict. That leaves Iran without any feasible competition.
The fact that other countries are trying to reduce our share of transit is just competition. There's a political dimension and an economic one in it. If we want to analyze the competitive aspect, we have the natural advantage. But if we want to advance our competitive advantage in terms of higher volumes and reaching our goals, we need to develop our infrastructure and the related management systems. And for this development, we need investments.
Further economic integration with Iran, while a boost for business, will likely neutralize ongoing attempts by the United States to keep the Islamic Republic isolated. However, there is evidence that at least in this case, regional nations are choosing to ignore American preferences. Having said that, Iranian transport officials say that there are still many kinks to iron out. There is plenty more right after a quick diversion into world media. Here is how it looks on the page. Tehran Times reads, oil ship affiliated with Israeli billionaire hit by drone off Oman coast. Under the condition of anonymity, a West Asian defense official told the Associated Press that a drone carrying a bomb had attacked the oil ship Tuesday night off the coast of Oman. The official recognized the ship as Pacific Zircon, as an oil tanker owned by Eastern Pacific Shipping, bearing the Liberian flag. The Singapore-based corporation is owned by Israeli billionaire Eden Ofer. A commercial vessel was involved in an incident in the Gulf of Oman, the Fifth Fleet of the U.S. Navy informed Reuters. The attack has not yet been attributed to anyone. The Geopolitics asks, can Iran counter its rivals in Central Asia through a connectivity push? Iran has rapidly emerged as a major transport hub. Iran's strategic location as a connecting link between West Asia and South Asia gives it distinct leverage. Iran is trying to bank on this advantage and push for greater engagements with Central Asia. Iran lacks economic heft of its rivals. However, connectivity initiatives may give Iran an edge over its rivals in Central Asia. With transit routes and supply lines disrupted due to the Russia-Ukraine war, Iran's position as a connectivity point to South Asia, Middle East, Africa, and Southeast Asia could be a pivot with the landlocked Central Asian countries. The global economic power center shifting to Asia, Iran offers an attractive outreach to the Central Asian countries, to South Asia, particularly to India. With Russia's eroding influence, Central Asian countries would seek to diversify their external engagements. Iran's proposition as a gateway to South and Southeast Asia could lead to Central Asian countries strengthening their ties with Iran. Iran's role in trade and transit has increased considerably over recent years. In 2021, the country's overall transit traffic rose by 68%, while transit traffic by road doubled. Transit is forecasted to grow by another 25% by the end of 2022.
Today, the economy is the top issue. If you can provide a secure, short and economic route for your neighbors, either the immediate neighbors or beyond them, they will definitely choose your lands to cross. This will bring you the opportunity that other countries' economies will be tied up and dependent on yours. And as a result, you are no longer alone on the international stage.
In light of Iran's growing role in regional trade, the International Road Transport Union, IRU, and Iran's private and public sectors have held high-level talks recently on avenues for further expansion. IRU Secretary General Umberto de Preto traveled to Iran a few months back to discuss how the country can continue along this positive trade and transit trajectory. He held a series of high-level talks, including meetings with the Ministry of Roads and Urban Development, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Customs Authorities, and IRU member, Iran Chamber of Commerce, Industries, Mines, and Agriculture. The authorities and IRU expressed their satisfaction with how they have cooperated and successfully implemented joint projects to further improve east-west and north-south corridors crossing Iran. IRU Secretary General Umberto de Preto said, "The growth of Iran's transport sector in recent years has been impressive, making it the number one issuer of TIR carnets in 2021. The TIR carnet allows road transport of goods in transit between member countries of the TIR Convention. It facilitates the circulation of goods under duties and taxes suspension by simplifying the customs procedures."
The Chabahar part of the North-South corridor is very critical and very strategic to the point that Central Asian countries are very insistent about it. Incidentally, the president of Kazakhstan in his recent meeting with President Raisi repeatedly inquired about the development of the Sarakhs-Chabahar railway project because Central Asia needs to have access to the warm waters of the Indian Ocean.
IRU Secretary General also stated that Turkmenistan's recent opening of its borders will now connect China to Turkey and Europe via Iran, making the southern corridor a viable alternative to the northern one.
In my opinion, the China Beltway is a plan that seeks to intertwine China's development to other countries' development beyond its western borders, meaning that it will push business, economic, and maybe even security borders of China towards the West. Accordingly, however much we can interconnect our own development with China's, I believe our role in Beltway plan increases. I mean, we should make the grounds for cooperation in a way that Iran's development become linked with China's. Experience shows that China, especially in the Beltway innovation, has gone to places that environmental challenges are at the lowest. I think we can define a very good cooperation with China, although in terms of Belt and Road Initiative, the defined routes have always included Iran. In light of that, we can say we've been able to get a share of the east-west transit corridors.
IRU officials and Iranian public and private actors also emphasized the benefits of using digital trade tools such as those with the TIR system and the CMR Convention. The CMR Convention is a United Nations convention that relates to various legal issues concerning transportation of cargo by road. There was equally a strong interest expressed by the Transport Ministry to partner with IRU to further improve the professional competence of drivers and road transport managers through IRU training and certification programs.
Let me tell you a historical point briefly. The existence of many caravanserais in the geography of our dear Iran is indicative of the fact that we've had a transit role throughout the history. This means that Iran has always been the shortest, most secure, and most economical route for merchants. You can find caravanserais in every corner of the country that were chosen by merchants from other countries.
Meanwhile, the row between Europe and Russia over the Ukraine war, which resulted in harsh sanctions being imposed on the country, cornered the Russian government economically, and many European countries closed their borders on Russian goods, making it very hard for its traders to be able to access their destination markets. As a result, the country started looking for new ways for distributing its goods across the world, especially in Asia and the International North-South Transit Corridor, INST DC once again came under the spotlight.
Today we are in a position that the world is experiencing changes. Governments are not waiting to get the approval of bigger powers like America anymore. The changing of times has provided the opportunity for countries to take care of their own needs directly and through a network order. Today, the disaster that is happening to Europe in terms of energy is because the Europeans insist on their traditional line of thought to follow the American order and things.
The agreement for launching INSTC was signed by Iran, India and Russia back in 2000. However, despite all the interest and hype, the attention to the route faded in time due to geopolitical hurdles, including the global economic stagnation, the US sanctions on Iran, the conflict in Karabakh and the pandemic. Now the multimodal network of ships, rail and roads is once again gaining its importance as the most important trade link between Asia and Europe.
On transit corridors, due to potential benefits and added value for other countries, they would be willing to make investments. In fact, we have the potential for this scenario, but we need to decisively and quickly make our own plans for it, so that our competition won't get ahead of us in taking possession of our market share.
According to official data, one of the major advantages of this transportation route is that the cost of transporting goods through this corridor is 30% cheaper. For instance, it halves the time it takes to transport Indian goods to Russia. Iran can use this transit route to distribute European commodities in the shortest possible time and at a lower cost than other routes to the Indian Ocean and the Persian Gulf. It is predicted that after the full operation of INSTC, Iran will be able to earn $20 billion in transit profits annually, something helping it reduce its dependence on oil revenues amid the American unfair and illegal sanctions on the sector.
In my opinion, the weaknesses we can mention are beyond the structural issues. They are rather related to process topics, such as the conflict of interests that might happen in decision-making process or impacts of the structure of our financial order when we want to control one part of our financial system and that creates a limitation in another part of the system. As such, the transit sector works the same way. These types of limitations can be called the bottleneck of our transportation system.
The Islamic Republic has been taking serious measures for the development of its railway network, as well as its ports and shipping infrastructure, in order to encourage more countries to join the project.
We have a good amount of liquidity in the country. Considering the high rate of return that transit projects offer, we can issue bonds and provide the needed investment in these projects. But we can also create project funding and take care of financing this way. So these are some of the domestic methods available to us besides foreign investment. In terms of foreign investment, Foreign Ministry and the government are currently negotiating with Russia and some Eurasian countries. Implementation of some projects are imminent and we're looking forward to that.
Besides linking India to Europe via this corridor, Iran can connect Central Asia to the Indian Ocean and the Persian Gulf. Landlocked countries in Central Asia can use the corridor's railway to access the high seas. Kazakhstan, Turkmenistan, Turkey, Iraq, and Afghanistan have also shown interest in joining the huge project by linking their railways to that of Iran. Earlier this month, Kazakhstan reached an agreement with the Islamic Republic of Iran for using the country's rail network and the southern Shahid Rajai port for transiting goods to the Central Asian and Commonwealth of Independent States, CIS regions. That's all for today. Thanks for watching from the whole team. Do tune in again at the same time next week and each week after. And don't forget to leave your comments and topic requests. Bye for now.